Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Learning from the Germans, Race and the Memory of Evil, by Susan Neiman. Read by Christa Lewis. What happened, happened. This sentence is just as true as it is hostile to morals and intellect. The moral power to resist contains the protest, the revolt against reality, which is rational only as long as it is moral. Jean Amary, At the Mind's Limits. Not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it is faced. James Baldwin, As Much Truth as One Can Bear. History will not go away, except through our perfect acknowledgement of it. Stanley Cavell, Must We Mean What We Say? Prologue. I began life as a white girl in the segregated South, and I'm likely to end it as a Jewish woman in Berlin. Lest you suppose I'm tracing an arc that strides the space from perpetrator to victim, let me complicate the story. The question of whether Jews should count as white people was not quite settled in the South where I was born. There's an old saying, Reverend Wheeler Parker, who was Emmett Till's cousin, told me, if I was Catholic and I lived in the South, I'd be worried. If I was Jewish, I'd be packing up. If I was black, I'd be gone. When I was 8 years old, my best friend solemnly declared she could no longer play with me. We had a lot in common, a preference for building tree houses over playing with Barbie dolls, a love of books whose games in the woods often revolved around searching for a door to Narnia. Still, she ended our friendship after hearing that the Jews had killed Jesus. The temple where my family worshipped had been firebombed, and most of the Jewish community kept their heads down. I am proud that my mother did not. My parents had moved from Chicago to Atlanta shortly before my birth in 1955. My mother's involvement in the campaign to desegregate Atlanta's public schools was sufficient to earn her a photo in Look magazine and a number of late-night calls from the Klan. If we could not be reckoned to the perpetrators, neither did we consider ourselves victims. Jews had been slaves in the land of Egypt and, as such, were obliged to liberal solidarity with other oppressed peoples. That was the major tenet of my mother's homespun theology. Much later, it must have played a role in my decision to study philosophy and to find my way within philosophy to the work of Immanuel Kant, that dry Prussian professor who wrote The Metaphysics of Universal Justice. It was Kant who insisted that all rational beings should obey the same moral law, and not even God is exempt. None of my family was a victim of a concentration camp, or, as far as I know, a pogrom. Safely landed in Chicago by the early 20th century, my grandparents never spoke of the Eastern Europe they'd left behind. On the contrary, the only grandfather I knew was fiercely American. The first in his family born outside of Odessa, he had a touch of a Yiddish accent, but he adored Teddy Roosevelt, visited all the national parks, and served in both world wars. His love of Lincoln was so strong that when he came to visit his Atlanta grandchildren, he taught us all the words to Marching Through Georgia, which we blithely sang in an open convertible, oblivious to any impact it may have had on those Atlantans disinclined to celebrate the march that burned their city to the ground. Today it's easy to smile. No wonder I never felt at home in the place. At the time, it only enforced my sense that we were fighters for justice and right. Like any American child, I learned something about the Holocaust, but it was too far away to dent or even shadow my own life. What were present were moments like the sticky summer day in Georgia when my mother invited an African-American friend to bring her children across town to play in our yard. 5 years after Brown versus Board of Education, Native white Atlantans were threatening to close down the school system rather than integrate it, a threat some counties carried out. Using skills she'd learned in an early stint in advertising, my mother and her friends from the newly organized HOPE, Help Our Public Education, were working to forestall the violence the Supreme Court decision ignited elsewhere. Meanwhile, she wanted to prepare her children for desegregation by arranging what was not yet called a playdate. The black folks we knew were all someone's servants, and she wanted us to have equal and normal relations with African Americans who were not. That's why her friend from the movement was there. Our backyard was large and surrounded by woods where we could hide, hunt for arrowheads, play capture the flag. But it was too hot for any of that, and no amount of lemonade could change it. "Let's go to the pool," I said. "We can't," said my mother shortly. "Why not?" I began to whine. "We always go to the pool when it gets this hot." "We just can't," said my mother. I was too young to notice whether she and her friend exchanged glances. "Then can we go to the lake?" The park at Red Top Mountain was usually muddy, not as nice as the pool, but the air was getting stickier by the minute. "We can't go to the lake today either," said my mother. "Why not?" I demanded, encouraging my little brother to chime in. In the end, we had to settle for playing under the sprinkler that watered the grass. I didn't settle graciously. How could I guess that it was against the law for black and white children to swim together, not only in the big concrete pools to which white Southerners flocked on such days, but in the lakes that studded the county by the grace of God? As far as I could tell, my mother was just being unreasonable. Perhaps it was unreasonable to imagine she could construct normal relations, even for an afternoon, in a system as unreasonable and violent as the segregated South. I'm still glad she tried. By the time I knew enough to apologize for the embarrassment my fuss surely caused her, she had trouble remembering the day. Southern plants still pull me deep, as though I had roots there. Dogwood, honeysuckle, azalea, even a magnolia tree in the backyard of my childhood. The newness of green. Chlorophyll sounds like medicine, but that green is the color of life itself. It's the promise that grips us, the world that begins again with each new leaf and each new life, unmarred by sticky fingers or sandbox scuffles. My mother always wanted to follow the springtime, starting in the deep South and driving steadily north to catch that moment of color ever again. She never did. Every budding tree reminds me of her longing. Apart from the plants, what sticks in memory are the places I made my own. The smell of hot rain as it hit the marble steps of the local library I visited every week. The kudzu-draped ruins in the woods that must have been a mansion burned by Sherman's troops. We lived in one of the prettier, not-quite suburbs, on the edge of northwest Atlanta. But everything made it apparent. We were never of them. My insufficiently southern accent was suspicious. One day I turned in a homework assignment that the teacher had requested. We'd been told to ask our parents about their hobbies, the organizations to which they belonged. I still remember the look on my teacher's face upon reading that my mother belonged to the ACLU. "Isn't that a subversive organization?" "Mommy, what's subversive?" I had to ask when I got home. My mother's friends were the few liberals, mostly white and Episcopalian or Unitarian, who shared her political views. After the dismal failure of my own first friendship, I didn't try very hard to make more. and there wasn't another girl in the area who got lost in long discussions of the books she loved or preferred the woods to Barbies. To be honest, I was pudgy, nearsighted, and terrible at sports, any one of which could have left me feeling lonely even in Brooklyn. But I'd never been to Brooklyn, and I spent my childhood dreaming of leaving the South, either for Europe, which I knew entirely from Ludwig Bimmelmann's Madeleine books, or for Greenwich Village, which I imagined as a leafy but talkative town. At the age of 12, I got lucky. I joined the first integrated youth group in the city, the Actors and Writers Workshop, an after-school program that offered a handful of budding liberal bohemians a house where they felt at home. We were taught that theater and writing required hard work, not just goodwill. We all shared convictions about the issues at the forefront of Atlanta politics, but we didn't meet 3 times a week just to feel good about ourselves, though it did feel good to be somewhere we could share what were, at that time and place, minority values. We were making art, and the director we called Rob took his job as seriously as if he'd been on Broadway, not directing a bunch of lonely, lost kids who, in the years we got a grant from the city, performed on a flatbed truck parked in one ghetto parking lot or another. Our parents soon learned that the best way to get us to do anything, like homework, was to threaten to prevent us from going to the workshop. Even on the rare Saturday, when there were no rehearsals or classes, we'd gladly come to Juniper Street just to sweep the floors or diaper the baby. None of us suspected she would become Julia Roberts, and it wouldn't have mattered anyway. The workshop was an outpost, itself not altogether at home in Atlanta. We came to offer helpless condolences at Martin Luther King's house the day after he was shot, for the 3 eldest King children were part of our classes. Not much of the white South was in mourning when Dr. King died. Alabamans didn't cheer the way we did when Kennedy was shot, says the Alabama historian Diane McWhorter, whose finger on the Southern pulse is surer than mine. But at the time, we did think our troubles were over and the South would go back to normal without King stirring it up. If the South never felt quite like home, 5 years in Tel Aviv, decades later, failed to make me Israeli. Perhaps that's why I feel so easy in today's Berlin, which has become a haven for many who feel at home nowhere else. I'd hardly felt easy on first arriving at Bahnhof Zoo station to a gaggle of punks panhandling on the stairway, German shepherds at their feet. In my imagination, German shepherds called up ghosts screaming, "Halt!" or "Juden raus!" A couple of months at a Goethe-Institut in Freiburg had extended my vocabulary, but barely dented my fears. Berlin in 1982 was so far off the beaten track that it wasn't hard to convince more than one foundation to support me for the year I'd said would be spent studying German philosophy, though it was hardly the whole truth. Berlin had an aura that radiated, however faintly, all the way to Cambridge, Massachusetts, where I'd studied for 8 years. When I was asked, rather often, how can a nice Jewish American set foot in Germany, and for a whole year at that? I countered with a question. 40 years after the war, wasn't it as racist to condemn the whole German nation as it had been for Germans to condemn the Jews? My answer suggested that I had worked through the Nazi past sufficiently to forget all about it and focus on Kant and Goethe. I may even have believed it at the time. Now I know better. I came to Berlin not because I'd gotten over the Nazis. I came because I wanted to know more about them. I was writing about the nature of reason, and they provided a world historical question mark. I soon felt exalted by the heady sense of abandon, the feeling of being forgotten in a city in limbo. Neither East nor West but a state-subsidized playground between them, Berlin was studded with reminders of the war that no one had the inclination or the money to remove. We lived in splendid old apartments whose ceilings often sported cracked plaster angels, whose facades often sported mortar holes. We carried buckets of coal from the cellars to heat the tall ovens that kept us warm. And there was, of course, the wall, which was often the subject of dark irony, at least in the West. What else could you do with an object that, two decades after its construction, felt like a piece of the natural world? With ruins of one kind or another in your face at any moment, one popular bar called In the Ruins punkily fetishized its crumbling walls. It would take a great deal of effort, or a great deal of intoxication, not to think about history. And that was the most thrilling of all. Vergangenheitsaufarbeitung, working off the past, was one of the first words I added to my German vocabulary, which was slowly freeing itself from images of tight-lipped men in uniform barking, Jawohl! Working off Germany's criminal past was not an academic exercise. It was too intimate for that. It meant confronting parents and teachers and calling their authority rotten. The 1960s in Germany were more turbulent than the 60s in Paris or Prague, not to mention Berkeley, because they were not focused on crimes committed by someone or other in far-off Vietnam, but those considerably closer to home, committed by the people from whom life's earliest lessons were learned. That autumn of 1982, those who came of age in the 60s were adults in their 30s, working off the past with special intensity, for the 50th anniversary of Hitler's election was approaching. There seemed no end of books and speeches, as well as exhibits like The Architecture of Destroyed Synagogues, Gays and Fascism, Women in the Third Reich, Resistance in Neukölln. The Arts Academy offered workshops on making films about the Third Reich. There were performances of music the Nazis banned and performances of music they promoted, with lectures accompanying each. Neighborhoods competed with each other to explore their own dark history. This and much more could be found in Berlin, where a play called It Wasn't Me, Hitler Did It, that opened in 1977, would run for 35 years. My new friends warned me that Berlin was unique. It had always leaned left, while the rest of Germany was less inclined to face the skeletons in its closets. But I wasn't in West Germany. I was in the former capital of the Reich, whose eastern and western halves vied with each other to produce the best form of working off the past. As I took it all in, the half-buried fears I'd brought with me began to recede, leaving sympathy and admiration in their place. In 1982, most Americans in the city were members of the occupying army, and I was often the first Jew many Germans had met. Raised with images of Jews that were confined to gaunt prisoners in concentration camps or Orthodox men in prayer shawls, it didn't occur to them to apply the word to me. Conversation involved a perpetual balance between announcing it and avoiding it. I hadn't been raised in a particularly Jewish community. I hadn't yet been to Israel. If any book about Jewish identity seemed written for me, it was Isaac Deutscher's The Non-Jewish Jew. I had no inclination to deny it, if only they would ask. They never did. What happened instead was the sort of conversation I had with a pleasant man at a party of left-leaning activists and diplomats. You know, he said, after a second glass of wine had loosened our tongues, I bet you come from the southern part of the United States. How did you guess? I replied. I can't say exactly, he replied. It's something about the way you move, your voice, your hands. I imagine it's like the difference between northern Europeans and Mediterranean peoples. I began to laugh. As it happens, I was born in Atlanta, I told him. but I'm an atypical Southerner. What you're noticing is that I'm Jewish. The gentleman was mortified. Oh, no, he cried. That isn't something I would notice. That plays no role for me at all. Given minimal familiarity with American culture, and about a minute in my company, most people assume I grew up on the Upper West Side. It's not just the dark curly hair or the fact that I tend to talk fast and wave my hands at the same time. I can't explain it either, but the mixture seems to signal New York Jew. Such people find this story hilarious. Germans do not get what's funny. They were raised with the notion that Jewishness is something unpleasant and probably smelly, so that noticing it would be a sign of bad manners. Like white Americans, proudly asserting that they do not notice color, they fail to notice the history of assumptions behind that claim. Don't notice color? Is the sky blue or gray today? The leaves red or green? In 1982, I could not have known that the year I'd planned to spend there would mark me for life, turning a vague fascination with a city into a deep, complex love. Staying in Berlin made thinking about ethics a grounded, constant presence. Any concrete slab or bullet hole could remind you of moral questions. We are historical beings, unable to describe ourselves without describing ourselves in space and time. And unlike other animals, we cannot grow up without considerable input from our parents, with whom we need to come to terms if we are ever to truly separate from them. 2 decades after I unwittingly embarrassed the man at the party, I was part of the National German Committee to plan celebrations for the 2005 Einstein year. 100 years after Einstein made his most famous discoveries, the left-leaning government had decided to spend 20 million euros to show its support of science in general and of left-wing cosmopolitan, intellectuals in particular. As the only Jew on the committee, my main function would be as what Orthodox Jews called a mashgiach, someone who guarantees that the premises are kosher. There were exhibits, there were banners, there were lectures, and more. What if they made a mistake? I spotted one in an early brochure where Einstein was described as a fellow citizen of Jewish background. Did the committee know, I asked, that Einstein had expressly ridiculed that weird circumlocution? He just called himself a Jew, I said. Jews don't consider the word insulting. Is that so, Frau Neiman? Replied the Minister of Science. She was flustered. That's very helpful. Just the sort of thing we need to know. Jew, in German, has 2 syllables, not 1. And I suppose that buried deep in some dreams are memories of sinister mobs shouting, Jude, Jude. Perhaps even for atheists, echoes of Judas Iscariot play a role. Germans use phrases with 9 syllables like fellow citizen of Jewish extraction or fellow citizen of Jewish heritage in order to avoid using the obvious 2. The habit is so ingrained that despite my objection, the second draft of the brochure used the same phrase. I know we all have many duties here, I said at the next meeting. But perhaps it has been forgotten that I mentioned that Einstein didn't like this designation. He made fun of it several times. I was learning to use certain forms of polite circumlocution myself. Of course, said the minister's deputy. We'll see it gets changed. They never did. Too many nightmares worked against them. Between the encounter at the party and the committee meeting, my life took several turns. I'd seen nascent working off the past in the 1980s, and I left Berlin because stories like the first bothered me more than the occasional right-wing rhetoric or traces of Nazi jargon. I had married a Berlin poet, and after our son was born, I began to long for a place where a Jewish child could be someone ordinary. That wish, I confess, was compounded by the widespread Berlin opinion that nothing very interesting would ever happen there again. My first book, Slow Fire, described Berlin life in the 80s, which were drawing to a close around the consensus that the action had moved elsewhere. A year before the wall fell in 1989, I accepted an offer to teach philosophy at Yale. Even without a premonition of what might be in store for the city I'd left behind, I spent my second night in Connecticut drinking an entire bottle of wine in tears. The difference between Berlin's intensity and New Haven's dismal mixture of suburb and ghetto was screaming. But a contract had been signed, an apartment abandoned, and I settled in to enjoy what there was to enjoy. Wonderful students, interesting new friends. After my twin daughters were born, there was no time for regret or much of anything else. I did apply for a professorship in Potsdam, but my marriage had ended by the time I received it. Instead, I took my children to Israel for a sabbatical, hoping to find a home. We stayed 5 years and became Israeli citizens while I taught philosophy at Tel Aviv University. They were young enough to assimilate easily, while I chewed on Ben-Gurion's claim that the first generation of immigrants to Israel would always be lost. All that mattered were the children. My misgivings were not political. The peace process had yet to collapse. The Second Intifada was still to come. But when approached by the Einstein Forum, which was looking for a new director, I wasn't entirely closed to alternatives, even though I said no at the start. Do you actually know what the Einstein Forum is? The more I learned, the more I was tempted. The Einstein Forum was founded just after German reunification with two concerns in mind. The first was the wish to build intellectual and cultural institutions in the former East Germany, whose own institutions had been gutted through the removal of anyone considered close to the fallen communist regime. There were already complaints that the wave of removals served as an excuse to find jobs for West intellectuals who'd been unable to get them on their own turf. Hiring an American, therefore, was one way to sidestep East-West strife. The second concern was less local. Disturbing signs of right-wing nationalism had emerged in the wake of reunification, and every single one attracted international press. At the same time, Brandenburg, the largest of the new states, which surrounds Berlin as Virginia and Maryland surround Washington, discovered that it had symbolic treasure in the form of a dilapidated wooden cottage Albert Einstein built in 1929. What better way to send a signal for internationalism and progress than to throw a little money in its direction and hope something interesting might emerge? I knew none of this when invited to apply for the job. Is there an intellectual agenda I'd have to follow? I asked at one of several interviews. Because if you're hiring me to be a Jew coming to Germany from Israel, I have to say I don't intend to spend the rest of my life talking about Vergangenheitsaufarbeitung. Somewhat hilariously, I thought I was done with the subject at the time. You'd be free to do whatever you want, I was told. Like, talk about the Enlightenment? This is Potsdam. We'd love it. Most of my philosophical work has been devoted to defending the much-maligned Enlightenment, that 18th-century movement which created the foundations for universal human rights. Potsdam is the home of the summer palace where Frederick the Great entertained Voltaire and other Enlightenment thinkers. The emperor later had the philosopher arrested, but for 2 years they had a good run discussing the best and the worst of all worlds. My teenage heroes were de Beauvoir and Sartre, so I'd never felt entirely at home in the Ivy League. The chance to open philosophical questions to a broad general audience was unique, and Potsdam was close enough to Berlin to allow me to live in the city that still touched my heart like an unresolved love. It couldn't be all over between us. There remained the question of what it meant to raise three children who considered themselves Israeli in the former capital of the Third Reich. Today, nothing in Tel Aviv is trendier, but in 2000, I was called a traitor for merely considering leaving Israel for Germany. A decade earlier, I'd decided against it. There seemed no way that foreigners, much less Jews, could feel truly at ease in Berlin. But watching an African man in dreadlocks talk back to a careless driver on one of several trips I made to discuss the job convinced me. The new Berlin wasn't just a matter of hype. The thought of a foreign, any kind of foreign, comeback at a German on a street corner was unimaginable in the 80s. We were all too frightened. Was it the change from a long conservative tradition to a social democratic green government? The fact that the capital, and with it more foreigners, had moved to Berlin? Whatever the causes, you could feel it on the street. The changes were dramatic, certainly enough to suppose that three Israeli-American German children could grow up there without feeling they had to cower. 20 years later, I still wake most mornings feeling grateful for my good fortune. The Einstein Forum is thriving, and I was lucky to find a lovely apartment in a neighborhood still dicey enough to be affordable. On sunny summer days, you'd be forgiven for thinking you've landed in a multicultural heaven. On my block alone, there's a Kurdish, a Finnish, and a Brazilian cafe, where live music spills out onto the sidewalk on warm evenings, a Danish bakery, a Moroccan restaurant, and a Greek delicatessen. Walk 10 minutes in any direction, and you'll find one of 9 small bookstores. One specializes in Polish literature, with poetry readings and music some evenings, another in English fiction. On Tuesdays and Fridays, you can buy bread and fish, fruit and cheese, and most anything else you need at the outdoor market next to the canal that used to be called Oriental. Though about half the vendors and a third of the buyers are Turkish, some functionary in the New Berlin clearly worried about Orientalism and changed the name to something innocuous. I cannot swear that the functionary read Edward Said, but I know that the police chief of my district saw the movie about Hannah Arendt. There are many women who cover their heads, the older ones rather grimly, the younger ones with style and sass. In this part of town, the jostling, bargaining, and banter between Muslims and non-Muslims at the market is unfailingly friendly. Yes, of course, I read the news, and even if I didn't, I have plenty of friends who do. In the wake of the heavy press coverage of the Israeli Arab attacked in 2018 for wearing a kippah, one worried old friend wrote from Los Angeles, "Were my children and I safe?" Anti-Semitic incidents in Germany get more international press than such incidents elsewhere. What receives far less attention is the way that Germany reacts. Even before the kippah attack was recorded on video, Chancellor Merkel had created a new high-ranking office to combat anti-Semitism. After the attack, 2,500 Berliners, including the foreign minister, demonstratively wore kippot at a rally in front of the Jewish Community Center, and the demonstration was front-page news for days. "Berlin wears a kippah," was the headline in my local daily paper. A few days later, the parliament voted unanimously to officially declare the existence of the State of Israel a part of German Staatsraison, reason of state or national interest. Anti-Semitism, says the new official in charge of combating it, has remained fairly constant in 20% of the population, now intensified by 2 complicating factors I'll discuss in the final chapter of this book: the rise of the far-right AfD, Alternative for Deutschland Party, and the influx of Muslim refugees raised on anti-Jewish propaganda. It's not far from the percentage of anti-Semitism in the United States, as soon as you leave the large cities. And it's certainly no worse than the levels of anti-Semitism in Great Britain. The difference lies in the response to it. In Germany, condemnation of anti-Semitism was swift, sharp, and serious. It came from the top of the government and was echoed by most voices outside it. In the United States, after Charlottesville, Nazis were excused. In Britain, the Labor Party's response to charges of anti-Semitism was self-destructively slow. No one in Germany denies there's more work to be done. This became especially clear in 2017 when Merkel's Conservative Party lost votes and the new far-right party gained them in the wake of her 2015 decision to admit 1 million refugees. Good Germans are ever on the watch for signs of resurgent racism. They view those developments with gloom and expect that worse will follow. What will develop in a world where the number of refugees is growing is anyone's guess. What's clear is that Germany's past no longer provides complete immunization against the wave of nationalism now sweeping the world. None of those developments cut against the fact that Germany was the only country in the world that showed any leadership on the refugee crisis. The German historian Jan Plumpe showed that, despite the AfD, active engagement to support refugee integration grew from 10% of the German population in 2015 to 19% in 2018. The last figure was determined by Germany's renowned Allensbach Institute, and it showed that far more Germans supported the refugees than voted for right-wing parties. What's been termed the welcome culture is the largest and broadest social movement in Germany since the war. Had Americans wished to compete with German generosity, they would have had to absorb 5 million refugees within a year on a fraction of the landmass. Instead, anti-immigrant campaigns succeeded in persuading Britons to leave the EU and electing an unhinged swindler in America. What about the Jewish question? 30 years ago, I wish that Germans were aware I was Jewish, or at least weren't shocked when they found it out. Although they often knew quite a lot about concentration camps, they knew next to nothing about living, breathing Jews. This year, several German friends sent emails wishing me Happy New Year in Hebrew. A Swiss Jewish historian is the president of the German Historical Museum. Berlin now hosts an annual Jewish film festival, a Jewish culture week, an Israeli-German arts festival, several Jewish magazines, and no end of hummus joints. Should you wish to become a rabbi, you can choose between a reform, a conservative, and an Orthodox seminary. Thanks to Chabad immigrants from Russia and the Lauder Foundation, the Orthodox Jewish community is growing, as is the community of Israelis who leave their country to escape its Orthodox-dominated government. Being Jewish is so fashionable that a number of German rabbis are actually converts. Buying matzah in the 80s was not quite secret, but it carried an aura of stealth. There was only one store that sold it, along with kosher wine, gefilte fish, mezuzot, and falafel. After the store was bombed in 1977, the owners exchanged the sign, reading Shalom, for one that read Oriental Specialties. You had to know where you were going in order to get there. Now, the only problem in shopping for Pesach is the fact of competition, as I discovered on a last-minute search for matzah meal last year. Everyone was sold out. "We underestimated," said one owner. "Don't bother going across town. There's no matzah meal left in Berlin." As I was wondering how long it would take to grind matzah piece by piece, I remembered that the parents of Israeli friends who were coming for Pesach might bring an extra box. You read that correctly. Israelis left home to enjoy the Seder with their children and grandson in Berlin. Next year in Jerusalem? Nothing reflects the change in spirit more than the commemoration of May 8th. In 1985, President Richard von Weizsäcker made headlines as the first major West German politician to call the day the war ended a day of liberation. Until then, the German defeat was viewed with ambivalence, and whoever was not ambivalent kept quiet. I failed to appreciate the speech at the time, for I could not grasp that the taste of defeat was still so bitter 40 years after the war that Weizsäcker's use of the word liberation was revolutionary. Imagine Virginians celebrating the Confederate surrender at Appomattox, and you'll have a rough idea of the effect. Today, one of the directors of the Maxim Gorky Theater is Israeli, and the theater produced a 3-day festival to commemorate the war's end. There were edgy theater and video productions, sassy dialogue about Jewish and Muslim gay men, a comedy about circumcision, and a discotheque playing a mishmash of hip-hop and Russian folk. "We have something to celebrate!" shouted one of the organizers as we danced to an accordion in the foyer. Outside the theater, over Berlin's largest boulevard, a flag fluttered. "We won," it read in German, English, and Russian. After Weizsäcker's speech, anti-fascist Germans, foreigners, and the few Jews in town breathed a sigh of caustic relief. Finally, a West German politician admitted that May 8th was not a day to mourn. But celebrate it with a flag that declared, "We won"? I cannot imagine who would have dared. Years ago, I promised myself to answer every stranger who took the trouble to write to me at least once. That probably reflects the letter I received from C.S. Lewis when I was 7, after I wrote to say that I too wanted to be a writer and enclosed a poem about Narnia. He was kind enough to overlook the quality of the poem and send an encouraging answer. I was elated. Stewart's letter contained some praise for a short article of mine that became the kernel of this book. The article had landed on the internet, and Stewart's letter was immensely serious. I reproduce it here in part. "I have lived in Mississippi my entire life, Oxford now, and I am a white conservative. Hilariously, at this point, that must mean I am a racist, I suppose, but in fact I, and many like me, genuinely do wonder what the right thing to do is with regard to the history of the southern states in America and the history of the United States in general. Your article provided substantial guidance for me." But Stewart wanted more, and his letter continued with a list of questions. "What do you think? Should we tear down all Confederate statues? Should we rename all buildings and streets? Should we take this cleansing past things relating to the Civil War and take Washington off the dollar bill? For your reference, I have asked numerous alleged civil rights leaders in Mississippi, and I even had the opportunity to eat dinner with James Meredith and hear his take on the issue. The sides are split, but man, oh man, those who think we need to eliminate all vestiges of the slavery era are the angriest. But are they right?" I wrote back to offer a few concrete suggestions and concluded by noting that if all self-described white conservatives were as thoughtful as he, the country was in better shape than I thought. I didn't need the election of Donald Trump, as terrifying as it was ludicrous, to prove that it's not. Had it started in Ferguson, with the acquittal of the man who shot Trayvon Martin? By the time a smirking, dead-eyed kid named Dylan Storm Roof killed 9 African Americans at a Bible study group in Charleston, the crisis seemed as clear to the white people who'd been able to ignore it as it was to the black people who'd never forgotten it. The heartache that gripped America was not just about the fact that the massacre took place in a sanctuary. There were also the voices of many victims' families declaring hate would not win. Roof's computer was full of white supremacist propaganda and pictures of himself holding a Confederate flag. There seemed to be a moment of consensus, even in the South. The video that showed massive goodness responding to purest evil lowered the flag and moved President Obama to Charleston to deliver one of his most powerful speeches. The president looked ashen as he began, presumably sickened by the thought that those bullets were meant for him. The recent rise in racist terror is not in spite, but because of the fact that we finally elected a black president, and the huge security details surrounding him led white supremacists to seek softer targets. Looking shaken in the beginning, Obama talked himself into the cadence of the mighty black church, mixing politics and religion into a binding, spellbinding whole. "Taking down that flag," he said, "is not an insult to the valor of Confederate soldiers, but simply an acknowledgement that the cause for which they fought was wrong." Nor did he stop there. "By taking down that flag, we express God's grace." And after a long riff on grace, just as deft as any jazz man's, Obama began to sing Amazing Grace in a voice so good it made you wonder why he hadn't chosen an easier line of work. The delighted audience sprang to its feet and sang with him. It was working, wasn't it? Obama's eulogy called on the nation to use history as a manual for avoiding the mistakes of the past, a roadmap toward a better world, and with Southern states voluntarily shedding Confederate symbols, something new was clearly happening in America. Like that of every other deep Southern state, South Carolina's governor was Republican, and still she presided over the ceremony that lowered the flag from the state capitol and readied it for a museum. Alabama's governor followed suit. Some stores announced they would no longer stock Confederate memorabilia. In that bitterly hopeful moment, I resolved to write a book expanding on the essay that prompted Stewart's letter. It seemed a time when Americans and others could use an example from someone else's violent history to learn how to come to terms with our own. A couple of weeks after the president's speech, I got another email from Stewart. In the wake of all the post-Charleston discussions, he wanted me to speak at his alma mater, Ole Miss. I wanted to look into what was being done by those who work on race and history in the Deep South. That's how I wound up as a guest of the William Winter Institute for Racial Reconciliation in Oxford, Mississippi. By tracing the differences between Vergangenheitsaufarbeitung in Germany and the United States, this book will encourage Americans and other peoples to learn from the Germans. It's significant that while there are many variations on the concept in German, Vergangenheitsverarbeitung, Vergangenheitsbewältigung, Erinnerungskultur, no similar concept exists in English or in other languages as far as I could find. In the 3 years during which I wrote this book, most every German I know rejected the comparison between the crimes of the Nazis and those of American racists, even after the 2017 demonstrations in Charlottesville showed they now use the same symbols and are equally ready to kill. That rejection, I'll argue, is itself a sign of how far Germany has come in taking responsibility for its criminal history. For entirely different reasons, many Americans reject the comparison too. Thus, the book begins with an attempt to answer their arguments, while acknowledging the obvious. No two histories are ever entirely alike. The first two parts of the book are, broadly speaking, empirical. Part one sketches the history of Germany's attempts to come to terms with the Nazi period, both before and after reunification. In rejecting the common view that the GDR did not confront the Nazi period, I do not claim its confrontation was flawless, By examining the attempts of the pre-1989 BRD and GDR with equal seriousness, I compared the different flaws that riddled the ways each half of Germany faced and avoided its Nazi past. Nothing fueled Cold War hostilities in Germany like the charge that the other side lived in unbroken continuity with its Nazi legacy. If contemporary East and West Germany could recognize that each side made different progress in breaking that continuity, while each managed differently to maintain it, a deeper reunification would be possible. Part 2 is devoted to the legacy of racism in the American Deep South. Concentrating research there by no means implies that racism is absent in the rest of the United States. But the consciousness of history to be found in Mississippi, for example, puts all the questions out in the open. Adam Nossiter argued that Mississippi is as culturally distinct from the South as the South is from the rest of the country, comparing it to a laboratory, a continuous experiment in which people are forced to learn how to live with their past. C. Van Woodward wrote that the experience of evil and the experience of tragedy are parts of the Southern heritage that are as difficult to reconcile with the American legend of innocence and social felicity as the experience of poverty and defeat are to reconcile with the legends of abundance and success. I spent half a year there, learning from people working in the South to change American culture at its broken heart. While systematic racism infects processes and affects lives all over America, Southern awareness of history makes it impossible to ignore. Moreover, the influence of the South on American political culture is disproportionate to the size of the region. Focusing on the Deep South is not a matter of ignoring the rest of the country, but of holding a magnifying glass to it. The surveys of these two very different histories of confronting and avoiding national legacies should give the reader an overview of how things are today. In Part 3, I wrestle with questions of how things ought to be. What is our responsibility to our national pasts? How should children be educated? Monuments built or removed, reparations for injustice organized, political cultures constructed. This book does not pretend to offer answers to all the questions it raises. If it provokes others to think further, its purpose will be served. I was trained by the great theorist of justice, John Rawls, but Rawls, as he regularly and diffidently insisted, wrote in the abstract. In writing this book, I sought as much particularity as possible. I spent much of 2016 and 2017 recording hundreds of hours of interviews in Germany and the American South with people who have played major roles in contesting and reframing their nation's public memory, as well as people who have been affected by them. There are good books in English, and whole libraries full of them in German, examining Germany's confrontations with its past, as there is an increasing body of work detailing American responses to Reconstruction or the age of racial terror rendered harmless by the silly expression Jim Crow. I make no effort to add to historical records, however often I have drawn on them. To quote the Bulgarian-French critic Tsvetan Todorov, the historical facts are well known and easy to look up. But facts don't come with their meanings attached, and it is the meaning that interests me. Although philosophy, like history, is always a search for understanding, it's a discipline whose bones are normative through and through. How should we live in a world riven with evil is the question that has driven philosophy since its beginnings. If the world were as it should be, thought Schopenhauer, philosophy would have no reason to raise any questions at all. Since I believe that abstract ideas become most compelling when refracted through particular experience, I have alternated between analysis and anecdote in the conviction that concrete historical examples will not obscure general moral questions, but illuminate them. The goal is to wrestle with questions about how working off the past can prepare the ground for freer futures, and how it can become a process that blocks access to them instead. My aim is to explore how the past should and should not be used in thinking about our moral and political futures. This kind of moral training helps us recognize complex forms of evil as well as simple ones, and prepares us to begin to prevent them. It's training that should not be confined to historians, but must become a matter of shared public memory history no thinking man or woman can honorably ignore. Some historical claims made in these pages will be controversial. While I've worked to support them, particularly through my choice of interviews, I'm well aware that other subjects would tell stories differently. I am not a neutral observer. This story is also my own. The decision to use a first-person voice was not, however, born from conviction that history is irrevocably subjective. It's a way of locating and taking responsibility for my claims. Where I have models for philosophical reflection on urgent moral questions, they are Jean Amary and Hannah Arendt. Each provides standards for that critical thinking which, in an age that values science and technology over every other intellectual enterprise, is needed more than ever. These pages will show how excruciatingly hard it was for Germany to accept the burdens of its shameful history, and that acceptance was nonetheless possible. The rise of the AfD has led many to doubt the progress Germany has made in the past several decades, and even to lament that we're living through a Nietzschean eternal return. Yet it's absurd to give up on the process of Vergangenheitsaufarbeitung just at the moment when it's under attack. Vergangenheitsaufarbeitung isn't a foolproof inoculation against racism and reaction. The world is unlikely to suffer a shortage of fools. Progressive democratic values show their merit in the ways they respond to those who seek to undermine them. When the AfD attacks decades of efforts to work off the Nazi past as shameful, it is imperative that the rest of us insist that shame can be the first step toward responsibility, and with that, toward genuine national pride. By examining German attempts at redemption through the lens of the failures of others, we can learn to cherish the work that has been done and to safeguard it from those who seek to undo it. Part 1. German Lessons. 1. On the use and abuse of historical comparison. Evil is what others do. Our people are always very fine people. In the ancient world, an evil action could pollute the community without being intentional, as the story of Oedipus reminds us. Even those who subscribe to the doctrine of original sin in the abstract tend to ignore it when things get particular. We have a natural impulse to believe that we and our tribe may make mistakes, but nothing that merits a word like evil. The impulse is just as strong toward evil's past as evil's present. We want our ancestors to be honorable and honored. My grandfather died for the homeland he loved. What's criminal about that? My great-uncle wasn't a racist. He was simply defending his home. If you followed the debates over the removal of Confederate flags and monuments that began to swell after 9 churchgoers were massacred in Charleston in 2015, you will recognize such remarks. Some were made by white supremacists who, enraged by the presence of a black man in the White House, knew exactly why they wanted to keep Confederate flags flying. Those who were less malicious, if also less honest, clung vaguely to family tradition. As those debates continue, you will hear variations on that theme from Richmond to New Orleans. Unless you've lived a long time in Germany, you'll be surprised to learn that descendants of the Wehrmacht made the same claims as the descendants of the Confederate Army. Not only in the dark, shell-shocked days that followed the unconditional surrender outside Berlin in 1945, such remarks continued to be made in public through the end of the 20th century, when the Wehrmacht exhibit broke West Germany's final taboo. Created by the Hamburg Institute for Social Research, the exhibit used soldiers' letters and photographs to reveal that Nazi military crimes were not limited to elite SS units, nor confined to a few bad apples. The Institute, which organized the exhibit to commemorate the 50th anniversary of the war's end, never expected the reactions it provoked. After all, the claim that the Wehrmacht systematically committed war crimes seemed, to foreign observers and even most German historians, about as controversial as the claim that the earth is round. But the gap between historical scholarship and ordinary public memory proved tremendous. With 18 million members, the Wehrmacht included a broader scope of German society than any other Nazi organization. Every German had a father, a son, or a brother who served in it, if they didn't serve themselves, and reactions to the exhibit showed how many still believed the myth that the Wehrmacht was clean, even gallant. Those brave men who defended their homeland against the Bolshevik menace were no better or worse than millions of soldiers before or after them. Originally planned as a limited project, the exhibit was seen in 33 cities by nearly a million viewers. It ignited media discussions, filled talk shows, and eventually provoked a debate in Parliament. Protesters balked at what they saw as an attempt to drag their forebears through the mud. In Munich, 5,000 neo-Nazis carried signs bearing slogans like "German soldiers, heroic deeds." In German, it rhymes. The good news was that even in Munich, the Nazis' original stronghold, 10,000 counter-demonstrators turned out to protest them. The Führer revealed how hard it is for scholarship to penetrate personal memory. For decades, German historians had worked to provide a detailed reckoning with the Nazi period, but there were layers of popular consciousness that work had not reached. The impact of the Wehrmacht exhibit was profound. As its initiator, Jan-Philipp Remsma told me the claim that the Wehrmacht was a criminal organization, so controversial at the time, now is self-evident. The exhibit became part of the history of post-war Germany. No German listening to the media at the time or studying post-war Germany since can fail to know something about it. When people point to Germany's attempts to come to terms with its criminal past, the Wehrmacht exhibit is Exhibit A. "But surely," said a sweet-tempered 60-ish man in Mississippi after I'd explained that the first generation of post-war Germans sounded like nothing so much as the defenders of the Lost Cause version of Confederate history. "Surely they knew, at the latest when they opened the camps, that what they'd done was pure evil." They did not. This book shows how the German people worked, slowly and fitfully, to acknowledge the evils their nation committed. Many books have been written, urging us to draw lessons from the Holocaust, some of them dubious. My interest is in what we can learn from Germany after the catastrophe was over. The story should give hope, particularly to Americans currently struggling to come to terms with our own divided history. Here's a key to understanding contemporary Germany. Nearly every German I know, from public intellectual to pop star, laughed out loud when they heard I was writing a book with this title. The exception was a former culture minister who didn't find it the least bit funny, raising his voice in a Berlin restaurant to tell me that I should under no circumstances publish a book suggesting there was something to be learned from the Germans. Just as it's become axiomatic for decent Germans to insist that the Holocaust was the worst crime in human history, which should never be relativized by comparison with anything, it's become axiomatic that this insight itself was far too slow in coming. German Vergangenheitsaufarbeitung was too little, too late, and above all incomplete, as the defensive reactions to the Wehrmacht exhibit revealed. Don't I know how long it took for Germans to make the switch from viewing themselves as worst victims to viewing themselves as worst perpetrators? Don't I know that many of them never made the switch at all? Don't I know there's still racism in Germany, currently represented by the AfD, the first radically right party since the war that won enough votes to be seated in parliament? Having spent most of the last 4 decades in Berlin, I do know these things. I'm a philosopher, not a historian or a sociologist, but for reasons that were deep and urgent, I've been straining to gauge the temperature of this once-fevered nation since 1982, most crucially, to determine whether it was a place fit for raising Jewish children. In 1988, I decided it was not. By 2000, I had changed my mind, for the changes that tentatively began in the 80s had taken root. In fact, it's the failures of Vergangenheitsaufarbeitung that should give hope to other nations facing similar problems. But that's only an apparent paradox. Social justice activists in the South, for example, who are struggling to force their neighbors to face the ways their racist history informs the racist present, are above all aware of how hard it all is. The acknowledgments are too defensive. The racism, too tenacious, the impulse to insist on one's own victimization, too strong. Learning that it took decades of hard work before those who committed what are arguably the greatest crimes in history could acknowledge those crimes and begin to atone for them brings enormous relief to those working toward similar acknowledgement in the United States. If even those raised in the heart of darkness needed time and trouble to see the light, why shouldn't it take time and trouble to bring Americans, nurtured for years on messages of their own exceptional goodness, to come to terms with homegrown crimes? The mechanisms and mistakes of the post-war German experience show a slow and faulty process that reflects the tentative steps America is taking toward justice and reconciliation. Failures foster hope, where it's clear that they lead not to final solutions but to progress that can be gauged by real differences in people's lives. For a few, the differences were lives made worse. In Frankfurt am Main and Philadelphia, Mississippi, men were finally sent to jail for murders committed in times and places where the murders were not considered crimes. For many more, lives were made better. 1 million refugees were welcomed by cheering Germans, eager to reverse the racism of their forebears. And the later backlash does not change that fact. And 2 terms in a row, my president was black. The achievements of Obama's presidency, especially impressive in the face of massive opposition to every move he made, undermined the last rationalizations for white supremacy, which is just what provoked the massive backlash that led to the election of the least qualified man ever to approach the White House. Obama's term in office could not overcome the wave of hatred he and his family endured with such grace. But the fact that it was possible is a fact to be cherished. For if the hopes it raised were possible, they are possible again. I will argue that the 2016 election resulted, in large part, from America's failure to confront its own history. In American and British life, the symbolic importance of the Nazis stands in inverse relation to common knowledge about them. Nazi just means the black hole at the heart of history, the apex of evil, the sin for which no expiation is possible, no condemnation sufficient. There is, of course, a wealth of scholarship about the Nazi period produced by American and British historians upon which I have often drawn, in addition to German sources. But my interest is public memory, what every half-educated member of a culture knows in her sinews, for it seeped into them in ways she can hardly remember. Things like your country's geography. Few Americans need pause to consider whether Colorado is west of Connecticut, as few Britons have to wonder whether Leeds is north of London. If you've forgotten everything else from your school days, you're likely to remember that. Britons and Americans know that 6 million Jews were murdered by the Nazis, as they know that Henry VIII had 6 wives or George Washington chopped down a cherry tree. But the absence of detail makes the Holocaust more of a mystery than anything else. There's detail aplenty about the mechanisms of murder, the appetite for yet another description of life within or on the way to the death camps seems insatiable. But with little knowledge of what led to fascism in Germany, and next to none of what happened after it, it's unsurprising that Nazi is simply a term of abuse that has been applied to everything from Obamacare by Ben Carson to Saddam Hussein by George Bush. Bill O'Reilly even used it to describe Black Lives Matter. No wonder a comparison between the violence inflicted on Jews by the Nazis and the violence inflicted on African Americans by Caucasians raises hackles, even indignation. Tendentious is the mildest objection white people raise. Slavery was wrong, but it was an economic issue. How can you compare it to the deliberate murder of millions? Who has the right to make comparisons? This is not a trivial question. The first people to compare Nazi racial policies with American ones were the Nazis themselves. It's noxious enough to learn how frequently those comparisons were made after the war in wretched attempts at exoneration. Even in playground brawls, "he did it first" is a miserable excuse. It's considerably worse when the genocide of Native Americans is invoked to justify the murder of millions of Slavic peoples. Alas, historians have shown that Nazi interest in American racial practices was present not only after the fact, but considerably before it. In the 1920s, Nazis looked to the American eugenics movement to support their own bumbling race science. Hitler took American westward expansion, with its destruction of native peoples, as the template for the eastward expansion he said was needed to provide Germans with Lebensraum, room to live. Nazi jurists studied American race laws extensively, particularly concerning citizenship rights, immigration, and miscegenation, before drafting the notorious Nuremberg Laws. Chillingly, those jurists found American racial policies too harsh to apply in Germany, and replaced the infamous one drop of blood model by which American law determined race with more lenient criteria, allowing Germans possessing but one Jewish grandparent to count, shakily, as citizens. On the other hand, they appreciated the ways in which American legal realism demonstrated that it was perfectly possible to have racist legislation, even if it was technically infeasible to come up with a scientific definition of race. The best of those jurists dug up the worst quotes of Lincoln and Jefferson in support of racist policy. None of this suggests that American racism was the cause of German racism. Racism is a universal phenomenon that takes many forms. The fact that the United States had the world's best developed racist legislation, which the Nazis eagerly studied in the 1930s while formulating their own, is disturbing enough without causal connections. After the war had leveled their cities, Germans were no less inclined to compare. Wasn't the massive Allied bombing of civilians a war crime as severe as anything the SS had committed? While the focus was usually on the firebombings of Hamburg and Dresden, which were seared into post-war memory, references to the atomic holocaust of the Japanese can still be heard in Germany and Austria, but only from those whose political allegiances tilt far right. Those comparisons were always central for Germans who tried to exonerate Germany by arguing that Wehrmacht war crimes were no worse than those of the Allies, Nazi genocide no worse than the European genocide of Native Americans. I do my best to follow Tsvetan Todorov's wise injunction. Germans should talk about the singularity of the Holocaust. Jews should talk about its universality. You can derive the principle from Kant, but it's also a variation on an idea we should have learned in kindergarten. If everyone cleans up her own mess, we won't have to worry about anyone else's. Todorov's claim will only be problematic for those who think statements are exhausted by their truth value. In fact, as ordinary language philosophy has taught us, statements are often forms of action. A German who talks about the singularity of the Holocaust is taking responsibility. A German who talks of its universality is denying it. Germans insisting on universality are seeking exoneration. If everyone commits mass murder one way or another, how could they help doing it too? Germans were not the only ones to compare their own racist crimes with those of others. In the early 60s, before the Holocaust became sacrosanct, many African Americans did so too. When W.E.B. Du Bois visited the Warsaw Ghetto in 1949, he was shaken by the parallels he drew with what he'd called the century's greatest problem, the color line. After the 1963 Birmingham church bombing, James Baldwin said that white Americans share collective guilt for the persecution of black Americans as Germans did for their silence during the Nazi persecution of Jews. Our history isn't bloodier than others, he continued, but it is bloody. In conversations with Baldwin shortly after the Eichmann trial, Malcolm X remarked, "What was done to the Jews 20 years ago keeps us on the edge of our seat, wanting to kill Eichmann. No one tells them to forget the past." The comparisons were made by the civil rights hero Medgar Evers, who risked his life in the fight against fascism at Normandy, and even by the NAACP president Roy Wilkins, who was hardly known for radical views. Tellingly, no African American I met while researching this book found the comparison problematic. But after white nationalist demonstrators screamed "blood and soil" in Charlottesville, does the comparison require further argument? Blut und Boden is a Nazi slogan. Nor is there anything neo about them. What's new about torchlight parades, Heil Hitler salutes, and swastikas, except their increasing appearance on American soil? A Jew who insists on what Todorov called the universality of the Holocaust need not argue for exact equivalency between the Holocaust and the crimes of other nations. It's a matter of taking responsibility for the latter. Though I have spent almost as many years of my life outside the United States as in it, I remain at heart an American Jew. Readers who belong to neither tribe should note that there are as many ways to be American as there are to be a Jew. As such, I write appalled by my country's procrastination in confronting our own national crimes. A mixture of secondary school education and a steady stream of popular movies, television, and radio programs ensure that you needn't be a historian to know basic facts about Auschwitz. Indeed, to avoid information about Auschwitz, you must have spent the last 30 years in a hermitage. Unless you're a historian specializing in contemporary Germany, you are unlikely to have learned much about what Germans have done over the past 70 years to contend with the shadow Auschwitz cast. Germany's relationship to its history is complex enough to have spawned several long compound words. Though they've been called Germany's most distinctive export, there is no real translation of any of them. But working off the past is a reasonable approximation. The German word for debt is the same as the word for guilt. Both, it seems, can be worked off with sufficient effort. More recently, all those words are being replaced by the much vaguer term Erinnerungskultur, memory culture, to suggest that the debt can never be paid. In this book, I will use the older term, working off the past, since there is no other point to the exercises in memory. Vergangenheitsaufarbeitung came into use in the 60s, an abstract polysyllabic way of saying we have to do something about the Nazis. Outside Germany, many still think the Nazis' strength depended on illiterate mobs, a view unfortunately reinforced by the dreadful book and subsequent movie, The Reader. In fact, the highest proportion of Nazi Party members came from the educated classes. Their children demanded that their institutions be overhauled from top to bottom. For several decades, that overhaul has included not only legal examinations and school curricula, it has dominated public debate, created countless works of art, film, literature, and television, and changed the landscape of many German cities. In addition to the famous Holocaust Memorial, built on the most prominent piece of empty space in reunited Berlin, there are more than 61,000 much smaller but more unsettling stumbling stones, which the German artist Gunter Demnig has hammered into sidewalks in front of buildings where Jews lived before the war. Each small brass plaque lists a name and dates of birth and deportation. For comparison, imagine a monument to the Middle Passage or the genocide of Native Americans at the center of the Washington Mall. Suppose you could walk down a New York street and step on a reminder that this building was constructed with slave labor, or that this site was the home of a Native American tribe before it was ethnically cleansed. In the past few years, some universities have begun to mark the relationship between some of their spaces and the labor of slaves. What about the rest of the country? Both Washington's Mall and London's Hyde Park devote space to commemorating one instance of evil, the Holocaust. It's puzzling that an event that happened in Europe should assume such a prominent place in American or British national symbolism, particularly when the United States did so little to save Jewish refugees before the Holocaust and so much to ensure that former Nazis emigrated to the U.S. after it. And though a majority of British citizens favored changing visa restrictions in order to admit Jewish refugees, Foreign Office memoranda reveal that policymakers feared that the Germans might abandon extermination and aim instead at embarrassing other countries with floods of alien immigrants if they did so. Can the resources devoted to commemorating an evil that neither country did much to prevent be simply motivated by guilt? The question is seldom raised openly, for the only intelligible answer seems to be an anti-Semitic reference to the Jewish lobby. But as often in history, Jews can be used on the front line of many agendas. The prominence of the Holocaust in American culture, and to a lesser but significant extent in Britain, serves a crucial function. We know what evil is, and we know who was responsible for it. Though it's no secret that genocidal slaughter didn't begin or end with the Nazis, the claim that rounding people up and sending them to gas chambers is evil is the only claim that commands nearly universal moral consensus today. In a world where every moral claim is viewed with increasing skepticism, any agreement at all may be welcome. The problem is that a symbol of absolute evil gives us a gold standard by which other evil actions can look like common coin. The focus on Auschwitz distorts our moral vision. Like extremely nearsighted people, we can only recognize large, bold objects, while everything else remains vague and dim. Or, to put the matter in psychoanalytic terms, the focus on Auschwitz is a form of displacement for what we don't want to know about our own national crimes. Until very recently, the amount of material about the darker sides of American history has been far easier to overlook. The information was there, but it took work to seek it out. Once confined to university libraries and departments of African American or post-colonial studies, the history of slavery and the Jim Crow Reign of Terror are now part of general history curricula and popular culture. Though its critics overlook the references, at least one turning point, Quentin Tarantino's film Django Unchained, was influenced by German memory culture that the director witnessed while in Berlin to make his previous movie. British public discussion is more hesitant. As the former British Museum director Neil McGregor put it, "What is very remarkable about German history as a whole is that the Germans use their history to think about the future, where the British tend to use their history to comfort themselves." British school children learn that Britain abolished slavery before America did, but rarely about British responsibility for the slave trade. Most college students there are vaguely aware of a problem called Ireland, but lack the most basic knowledge of which part of the country belongs to the crown. And the history of British imperialism, "We built them roads and weren't half as bad as the Belgians," is so small a part of public consciousness that even educated Britons can be surprised to learn that their country is generally considered to be part of the history of European colonialism. Is an American's attempt to examine her country's crimes by the light or the dark of German history an exercise in self-hatred? Before you conclude this, you should consider that self-hatred is a running theme of the German right, which routinely refers to efforts like the Wehrmacht exhibit as dirtying one's nest. In fact, they're better described as Herculean acts of nest scrubbing, which make cleaning stables look simple. What readmitted Germany to the family of civilized nations only decades after the Holocaust and allowed it to become the leading power in Europe was the recognition of its crimes. Having the will to face your shameful history can become a show of strength. Evil isn't a matter for competition, though it is often treated as one. The deliberate, high-tech murder of millions is worse than the economically driven exploitation of slave labor. But more people died in the Middle Passage that brought captured Africans to the New World than were murdered at Auschwitz. If you want to focus on form, you could add that the Nazis went to great lengths to murder Jews, even after it was clear that trains and troops were desperately needed for the war effort. Nazi devotion to genocide was so great that it outrode even instrumental interests of reason. You should, however, remember that the gas chambers accounted for less than half the murders of European Jews and none of the 20 million Slavic peoples. The rest were killed by low-tech means, more or less organized shooting, burning, and bludgeoning were the preferred ways of killing on the Eastern Front. If you want to focus on number, you could argue that the number of hours captured Africans spent crammed into the holds of slave ships was higher than the number of hours spent by Jews pushed into cattle cars. Examples like these show the folly of entering into an Olympics of suffering. Quite apart from the fact that competitive suffering is bad for the soul, we have no means to measure evil scale. Trying to determine which evil is worse than another is a political project, not a moral one, and weighing evils against each other for political purposes is morally unacceptable. Today, there's at least this much consensus. Both the Holocaust and slavery and its aftermath were evil. Now what? This book is about comparative redemption, not comparative evil. Suppose you accept the view that the racism that led to the gas chambers and the racism that led to slavery and terror can be compared. Still, you may wonder, can we compare the processes that are meant to heal the wounds of such different historical events? Post-war Germany was ravaged and occupied by four victorious armies. Contemporary America was not. Even those who acknowledge that both have been infected with murderous racism may wonder about the cure. With such very different circumstances in the present, how can one attempt to overcome the past, provide lessons for another? Let's begin by counting the differences. 1. Germany was an occupied country for 45 years. Not until 1990 did a peace treaty declare the war to be over. As a thoroughly defeated nation, Germany had no choice but to acknowledge its crimes. The United States, by contrast, emerged from World War II not only victorious, but as a victor whom even pacifists acknowledged had been on the side of truth and right. Who could force them to admit they had sins to repair? The dates are incontestable. What's also never contested is the fact that the denazification imposed by the Allies in West Germany was a consummate failure. As I'll show, the situation in East Germany was more complicated. Like defeated Southerners under Reconstruction, post-war West Germans initially chafed under what they called victor's justice, and they mocked Allied attempts to impose a change of consciousness. From the Nuremberg trials to the forced visits to Bergen-Belsen accompanied by posters screaming, "You are guilty of these crimes," official efforts to insist on acknowledgement were almost uniformly despised. The best-selling West German novel of the 50s was The Questionnaire, one right-wing author's use of a denazification questionnaire to frame his own life story in a way that sneers, "The Allies are too stupid to get it," on every page. Admitting the failure of re-education programs and eager to put aside past enmities in the service of the Cold War, Western Allies discontinued those programs in 1951. Working off the past is not something that can be imposed from without. Only the internal confrontation, begun in the late 60s by the children of those who opposed any confrontation with the past at all, would have a chance. The history of racism in America is longer than the history of racism in Germany. The first slave was brought to Jamestown in 1619. In 1951, a delegation of clergymen visiting the White House with a letter of support from the ailing Albert Einstein failed to convince Harry Truman to make lynching a federal crime. This would have left it subject to federal rather than local prosecution at a time when local justice officials were often part of lynch mobs and certainly disinclined to prosecute them. Politically dependent on the support of white Southern Democrats, Truman said the moment was inopportune. With murderous racism so deep and long-standing, how can Americans hope to work off a past that the Germans have already begun to master? Once again, the dates will stand, but they need to be complicated by others. German racism has a long history, too. As in other European nations, Jews were forced to live in ghettos and rarely free from fear of pogroms through the late Middle Ages. They gained citizenship status only when Napoleon carried the principles of the French Revolution eastward on sword point. And the vaunted German-Jewish symbiosis was as late as it was wobbly. Though hailed in his day as the German Socrates, the philosopher Moses Mendelssohn was denied membership in the Prussian Academy. 150 years later, Einstein's membership was secured only after a recommendation assured that August Institute that he was free of all unpleasant Jewish characteristics. The year was 1914. He had already discovered relativity theory. The question is not which racism was longer, stronger, and more devastating, but rather, did the forms it took in America preclude the sort of atonement that has taken place in Germany? 2. The Civil War was over in 1865. World War II concluded 80 years later. If Germany has already proceeded quite a way down the path to redemption, what's taking the United States so long? Dates, once again. Diane McWhorter, author of a Pulitzer Prize-winning history of the Birmingham Civil Rights Movement, suggests that we should start counting from the passage of the Civil Rights Act in 1964. For however many forms of racism still continue, that was the moment racist policy was banned by law. De facto racist policies continue to this day, but their de jure abolition marked a dividing line. If you accept that reckoning, we are only 50 years from zero hour, about the place where Germany was when the Wehrmacht exhibit provoked the kind of backlash that the removal of Confederate monuments provoked in New Orleans. There are several reasons for American slowness in facing our history, and one is fairly simple. There's a 100-year hole in it, and few white Americans are even aware of that. For most of us, the period between the 1863 Emancipation Proclamation and the 1955 Montgomery bus boycott is a vague and cloudy blur. My own ignorance was enormous before I began work on this book. Even as knowledgeable a politician as Hillary Clinton managed to confuse Jim Crow and Reconstruction on the 2016 campaign trail. With all due allowance for campaign exhaustion, you should not have to think in order to be clear about the difference between them, any more than you'd have to think about whether Memphis is the same thing as Montana. Excellent work by Michelle Alexander, Edward Baptist, Douglas Blackman, Eric Foner, Brian Stevenson, and others has made us conscious of the ways that chattel slavery turned into slavery by other means. I will sketch that work in Chapter 8. Until this becomes the kind of knowledge that is mandatory in our classrooms and visible in our public spaces, we'll continue to hear the refrain, "Slavery ended in the 19th century. Why are we still talking about it in the 21st? There are sinister explanations for the presence of this hole in American memory, beginning with the concerted efforts of the defenders of the lost cause narrative of Confederate history. But one explanation is perfectly innocent. Americans prefer narratives of progress. Call them happy endings. Our stories are more aspirational than actual. We may acknowledge that wrongs were committed in the past, but we want to believe they were righted in a roughly straight line. Shortly after Trump's election, President Obama tried to cheer us with the remark that American history zigs and zags. But while the metaphor may have been soothing in a moment of national anxiety, it's too abstract to describe the turns America has taken. Frederick Douglass, the former slave turned abolitionist, said it early on. Racist violence occurs most often when black people advance. The Klan was founded in the wake of Reconstruction, the brief period following the Civil War when African Americans began to enjoy the rights that the Union victory had assured them. Decades later, black men proud to serve in the U.S. Army came home from world wars to face lynch mobs. Some scholars argue that fury over Brown versus Board of Education played a role in the murder of Emmett Till. The Confederate flag was raised in South Carolina, and the Stone Mountain Confederate Memorial completed in Georgia in response to early successes of the civil rights movement in the 60s. And there's no doubt that the presence of a black family in the White House enraged a sufficient number of Americans to ensure the election of a swindling, violent successor whose policies, such as they are at odds with the interests of all but a handful of billionaires. This is not an elegy for the possibility of progress. Barack Obama's election fulfilled dreams we didn't dare to dream in that most hopeful of decades, 1960s America, and it stirred hopes and hearts around the world. Until we realize, however, that the zigs and zags are not accidental, but have a clear and particular structure, we will be unable to make systematic progress again. 3. The Jewish community of Germany may be the fastest growing one in Europe, but it's still far below what it was at the time of the Nazi takeover, when it was less than 1% of the population. However you count them, the Jewish population of Germany will never be close to the 14% of the U.S. population African Americans make up. Jews in Germany are very hard to count because the only way to be counted is to join the official Jewish community. Doing so automatically tithes 1% of your income. But even those undaunted by the tax often feel alienated by the community, which is both strife-ridden and conservative. None of the thousands of Israelis currently living in Berlin take that step and hence remain uncounted, as do I. It's undeniable that African Americans are far more present in American life than Jews are in Germany, but that cuts both ways. The fact that so many Americans of African descent refuse to be anything but a vital part of American culture is also an advantage. Germans have been mourning the holes in their own culture since they drove out the Jews. And those of us who came, or came back after the war, cannot make up for those losses. Since Frederick Douglass, at the latest, the great majority of African Americans have rejected proposals to return to Africa. Instead, they have insisted on remaining to claim their full rights as American citizens. The American economy was built on the backs of enslaved men and women who cleared the land and tended the crops that created the wealth that was the foundation of U.S. prosperity. Equally important, American culture is unimaginable without the contributions of generations of black artists who forged forms of expression the world has come to know as quintessentially American. African Americans are inextricably part of American life, past and present, and that is a reason for hope. 40 million voices with 400 years of history cannot be swept aside. 4. Perhaps not, but that argument cuts two ways as well, for white racism continues and continues to be deadly throughout America. It's not just a matter of an unexamined past, but of a pounding, brutal present. In Germany, by contrast, there are no longer enough targets left for racism. In Germany, to some extent, Turks and other people of color became the target of venom once directed toward Jews. 9 of them were randomly murdered by young neo-Nazis between 2000 and 2007. The trial of the one accomplice, who remained alive after a self-made bomb blew up the others, shocked Germany. And the National Socialist Underground murders were not the only attacks of violence against brown people committed in Germany in recent years. It was disgust at an attack on a refugee asylum in 2015 that drove thousands of Germans to protest by streaming onto railway platforms to welcome trainload after trainload of incoming refugees from Syria, Iraq, and Afghanistan. It was fear over that welcome that gave seats in parliament to the first far-right party in Germany since the war. There is no doubt that vigilance will be needed for the foreseeable future. The past continues to seep into and infect the present. Working off the past is never finished or final. And for all the work that's been done to face anti-Semitism, even that hasn't entirely disappeared from Germany. My friends say I don't hear the worst of it. Few Germans would tell a public intellectual who's known to be Jewish the things they say behind her back. I'm sure my friends are right, since I do hear the softer sorts of insult. The suspicion that my professional success in Germany is a result of affirmative action will haunt whatever I do, as it haunts many an African-American in the United States. But what matters most is change over time. I left Berlin in 1988, largely because I wanted my son to grow up with a sense of normality that seemed impossible in a land with so many ghosts. One daycare worker had told me, "If I'd known he was Jewish, I wouldn't have taken him. Not because I have anything against Jews, they can't help what they're born as, but I couldn't have treated him like any other toddler." At least she was honest. 12 years, 2 children, and a change of government later, I returned to Berlin convinced that past and prejudice had been sufficiently worked off to allow Jewish children to grow up without feeling they had to remain in hiding. 2 of them, now adults, still live in the city that welcomes more foreigners every day. This is a significant change. I would not have taken them to a place where they or I would be forced to live in fear. Put slightly differently, I would not have taken them to a place where they'd be forced to walk past Hans Wehrmacht statues or flags flying swastikas. In sum, the circumstances surrounding racism in Germany and America, past and present, are not the same. How could they be? History is just as particular as the individuals who make and are made by it. What worked in one place can't be straightforwardly transferred to another. Seen in one light, the differences between German and American racist histories are glaring. Seen in another, what's clear is what the similarities can teach us about guilt and atonement, memory and oblivion, and the presence of past in preparing for the future. Many of the similarities are cross-cultural, as relevant for thinking about British as about Dutch colonization, though every attempt to work off past debts must attend to each nation's particular history. Forget the past and move on isn't even helpful in the realms of individual psychology. As political advice, it is worthless. When pasts fester, they become open wounds. What's common to both starts with language. In Germany, as in the southern United States, the war is a singular reference. Everybody knows that one was decisive, and its repercussions are with us today. This knowledge is more conscious in a deep South that was occupied and almost as devastated as Germany than in the rest of the United States. Still, many authors have argued for the continuing influence of the Civil War in American life, and some even claim that mainstream American political culture is a reflection of Southern attempts to win the war by other means. The centrality of the Civil War for all the American history that came after it is less clear to most Americans than the centrality of World War II for Europe. The great historian Tony Judd rightly called his examination of late 20th century European history post-war. The title could do for post-1865 America, were anyone to undertake as magisterial a survey of it, for the Civil War has cast an even longer shadow. Rather than focusing on the details of difference, we should use whatever lessons we can gather as we seek to come out of the shade. Germany was once proud to call itself the land of poets and thinkers. In the first angry attempts to confront the Nazi period, more than one wag suggested calling it the land of judges and hangmen. Dichter and Denker rhymes with Richter and Henker. Initially, German thinkers absconded from what should have been a moral obligation to reflect on the Nazis' assault on reason and right. Heidegger was merely the most prominent example. As most philosophers, like most other professors, supported the regime while it lasted, they avoided the subject once it was gone. But Karl Jaspers and his student Hannah Arendt, Theodor Adorno and his student Jürgen Habermas, as well as thinkers like the brilliant autodidact Jean Amary, all wrote many essays devoted to the question, what does it mean to live in the wake of past crime? German intellectual traditions prepared the way for this work in a way that American and British traditions, with few exceptions, do not. One distinguished English philosopher told me he was no more interested in the question of why some Germans became Nazis than he'd be interested in thinking about someone who declared he was a teapot. Both are simply mad, he said. Having learned much from German philosophy, my goal is to encourage a discussion of guilt and responsibility as serious as the German one, not in order to provide a set of directions, but rather a sense of orientation won through reflection that is no less passionate for being nuanced. Rules are rarely useful in matters of moment. Their judgment, which can only be based on serious reflection about particulars, is necessary. Understanding how the Germans have confronted their past will not provide recipes for confronting a different one, even were the German confrontation without flaw. Even in a single culture, there are seldom clear directions. Over lunch one afternoon, the president of Berlin's Academy of Sciences asked me if I'd come to take a look at the mosaic in the Academy's vestibule floor. He wanted a Jewish opinion, though he wouldn't tell me about what. As I stared at the floor, I saw that it was one of those duck-rabbit designs. If you looked at it one way, you saw an innocuous pattern. Blink, and you saw a series of interlocking swastikas. No one had noticed them until the President of Israel paid the Academy a ceremonial visit. Pacing in the vestibule, his bodyguard saw swastikas. Since displaying a swastika is illegal in Germany, the president of the academy received a summons from the district attorney. Had the floor been laid by the Nazis, there would have been few doubts about what to do. The trouble was that the floor was laid in 1903, nearly 20 years before the Nazi Party existed. It's an old Indian design, after all. Should they tear up the floor they had just spent part of 10 million euros to renovate, put a rug on top of it, put a plaque explaining the history? This is the usual solution for such questions in Berlin, and it is the one that president chose. His successor thought it better to take down the plaque and solve the problem with a rug. Examples like these show how endlessly complicated every confrontation with the past must be. Which streets should be renamed, which statues dismantled, how those who committed crimes should be remembered, and how their wrongs should be requited. None of these questions can be decided abstractly, once and for all. However similar national crimes may be, they are also relentlessly particular. and any attempt at reparation must be particular to. Only direct analyses of particular cases and contexts can help us to get the balance right. Critical thought about history and memory is evident in recent American debates that give reason for hope as Americans begin to see how the unexamined past forces its way into the present. It's too soon to tell, but the process that began in Frankfurt and Berlin in the 60s and changed the German nation may foreshadow the movement that began in Charleston and Charlottesville. However many the differences, all are animated by the conviction that our past will continue to haunt us if we do not face it down. An open reckoning with that past is a crucial step toward maturity that will allow us to envision a full-bodied future. For a grown-up relationship to one's culture is like a grown-up relationship to your parents. We all benefit from inheritances we did not choose and cannot change. Growing up involves sifting through all the things you couldn't help inheriting and figuring out what you want to claim as your own and what you have to do to dispose of the rest of it. 2. Sins of the Fathers. Nothing I ever learned in Berlin surprised me more than the recognition that most Germans once put their own misery front and center. For decades after the war ended, Germans were obsessed with the suffering they'd endured, not the suffering they'd caused. Hadn't they lost sons and husbands, fathers and brothers on the field? Hadn't most of the men who survived been taken prisoner, as often as not to Siberia? Hadn't the women and children spent night after night shivering in cellars from cold and from fear of the bombs that burned or blew their cities to bits? Hadn't they lost a quarter of the territory that belonged to Germany for centuries? Wasn't the winter after the war so bitter that the great trees that lined city streets were sacrificed to keep civilians from freezing to death? Hadn't they survived on dandelion greens and potato peels? Nor was all they endured during the war enough. Now they were being beaten with what would later be called a moral club. Did they really have to hear that the cause for which they'd fought and suffered was not only senseless, but positively criminal? Younger Germans couldn't entirely overlook the discrepancy between their parents' view of the matter and the views of the rest of the world. It's what led thousands born after the war to pass themselves off as Danish or Dutch when they traveled abroad. They knew what reactions the truth would provoke. There were cold shoulders, glasses slammed on a counter, even occasional spit. This was as true for young West Germans visiting Paris as it was for young East Germans visiting Poland. And they sought repair in different forms. But their parents had told them that the world's reaction was a case of victor's justice, if their parents told them anything at all. Most often, they did not. What the U.S. Declaration of Independence called a decent respect to the opinions of mankind may be absent in many a nation, but post-war Germany felt particularly entitled to do without it. Hadn't the rest of the world been wrong before? Only 20 years separated the end of one war from the beginning of another, and the memory of the Versailles Treaty was still fresh. Germans did no more at the beginning of that war than participate in the imperial power struggles few Europeans found problematic at the time. At the end of World War I, the carnage was so shocking that the victors looked for someone to blame and someone to punish. Not only did Germany lose quite a bit of territory, it was saddled with a bill for war reparations that left its economy dysfunctional. West German children of the war generation told me often enough that their parents opposed their own nascent attempts at atoning for the Nazi period, but they never conveyed the collective whine that was the emotional power behind their parents' opposition. Haven't we paid enough already? I needed decades to learn how deep those emotions had been. The German war generation paid quite a lot. First and foremost, 7 million lives. This was significantly less than the 27 million killed by the Wehrmacht in the Soviet Union alone, but 7 million was more than a tenth of the total German population, and hardly a family was spared. At least 1 million of the dead were civilians, though no one knows the exact number killed in the Allied air raids begun in retaliation for London and Coventry. If you lived in one of the cities they targeted, you were likely to lose your home and everything in it as well. When it was all over, like thousands of others, you combed through the rubble, grateful for an old photo, a child's doll, or a locket, anything that might anchor a memory of your past. There was very little to eat, and the winter of 46 was the coldest in living memory. Another number. One quarter of German territory was permanently surrendered. This meant that one quarter of the population lost whatever they couldn't carry when they fled west, fearing the Red Army might do to them what the Wehrmacht had done to Russian civilians. For the most part, it did not, but that couldn't be predicted. So millions of refugees swept westward, overwhelming compatriots who were likely as not to be bombed out themselves. This was hardest, of course, on the refugees, but not easy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.